diagnosis from theory to practice. احنا سعداء النهارده اللي معانا الدكتور خالد يونس. الدكتور خالد يونس عنده دكتوراه من جامعه دايتن اوهايو. موضوع الدكتوراه هو كمبيوتر ايد دايجنوسيس فور بريست. اشتغل بعدها كونسلتنت في شركه ايكل اللي هي برضه بيست في امريكا وسبيشاليز برضه في الكمبيوتر ايد دايجنوسيس بريست. بعد كده كان بروفيسور بايوميك انجينيرنج في جوردن يونيفرستي جامعه جوردن في عمان. وبعد كده هو دلوقتي بيبرزنت النهارده شركه تيرا ريكون. هو الميدل ايست ريبرزنتيف تيرا ريكون. دكتور خالد البرزنتيشن بتاعته هتبقى من جزئين، الجزء الاولاني حوالي 20 30 دقيقه وهيقدم فيها ثيري، والجزء الثاني برضه حوالي 20 دقيقه وهيقدم فيها through some sort of connection to the cloud، معرفش ايه الكلاود دي، الجزء البراكتيكال بقى اللي هو البرودكت.
شكرا. السلام عليكم. سعيد جدا بوجودي معاكم. وانا حابب انه اشارك معاكم الشعور اللي كنت لما كنت طالب زي بعضكم يعني. وبعدين اثناء الدراسه الفاز تبعي هو اللي بدأت شركة ايكال، كنا كونسلتنت معه واحنا لسه طلاب، وبدأت شركة صغيرة كنا نجتمع على يعني طاولة المطبخ عنده، وبعدين فتحنا مكتب صغير وكبر براءة اختراع، والحمد لله الآن شركة ايكال هي أكبر شركة في مجال الكمبيوتر ايد دايجنوسيس، ومنها انطلقت طبعا شركة تيرا. مش حابب اني اضيع الوقت عليكم. ف we will start with the presentation. CAD, when we say computer aided diagnosis, actually it's confusing because now there is no single term for CAD. Some people refer to CAD as computer aided detection, some people refer to it as diagnosis, and some people even say detection and diagnosis. So I try here to just let you know what's the definition of computer-aided detection, CAD-E. It's the automatic identification of conspicuous sections, something that's interesting. We want the computer to assist the specialist, in this case mainly the radiologist, to detect from medical images cancerous tissue, lesions, polyps in the colon, etc. So if the computer can assist the radiologist to do that, this is computer-aided detection. Diagnosis is one step further. It's to help the radiologist decide if this detection is malignant or benign. So he will have a better idea of that. Both are designed to help the radiologist, not to replace the radiologist, because ultimately the final decision and responsibility is on the specialist. The computer is only acting as a second eye or a second opinion. Some people even add CAD-Q, which is quantification, giving some measurements to the detecting nodules, etc. This can be very helpful. So all in all, CAD started in 1970s, and now it's actually very common, and everywhere I go to, they keep asking me, do you have CAD? Can you do the CAD? Something like this. So you know, we have a long way to go with CAD, by the way. It's not ready yet, but we keep adding. So this, for example, is a colon. And as you can see here, the computer pointed some areas to the radiologist to tell them that these are worthy of your attention. It's like queuing, give him a cue. Instead of looking at the whole colon, he can only look at certain parts. At first, radiologists were against that. The FDA, you know, wouldn't reimburse that. So, you know, there was a lot of work to do on the side of, you know, researchers to convince the radiologist that it's helpful, it's going to use you, help you, to convince the FDA that it's worth your reimbursement, can save actually insurance company money. Because if the computer can say that this tumor or suspicious tumor in the breast is benign, then there's no need for the woman to overgo the hurdles of biopsy and all of the trauma involved with that, and also the expense, because it's expensive. So they found that that's really helpful. It saves us some money. Now it's FDA approved. The value is added every time. Now, as I said, every diagnostic workstation in the PACS, in the hospitals, are asking to have the CAD option. That's for colon. Here, as you can see, this is cancer. And if my computer algorithm or your computer algorithm can point a circle over that cancer, this is really helpful, because it was proven that there are a lot of cancer was overseen by radiologists. They did not pay attention. Because if you look here, it's like you're looking at the cloud. And because of the fatigue, because of the energy quality, radiologists don't see that. So after 1 year or 2 years, the cancer grows, and then they go back. Let's look at the image 2 years, you know, in advance. Oh, it was clear already. So why did you miss it? So almost 66% of the cases where the radiologist overseen the cancer were detected by CAD. So it's really helpful. This is for lung, for example. Of course, not all CAD algorithms are the same. This is the output of two different algorithms. Like this one here, it's pointing to these nodules. And these nodules are early indication of cancer. Okay? And this one here, this algorithm, did not detect the right nodules. So there is really a chance for you to excel and write a certain code that can detect the cancer. You can have the database, it's available. You can write MATLAB codes, probably, or C, and you can try it. This was my PhD thesis. So the CAD methodology is actually it's like a combination of three disciplines: image processing, image analysis to get some features out of the image, and pattern classification, or artificial intelligence, or, you know, all these related sciences. So this is a general flowchart of the CAD methodology. As you can see, we start with the images. Usually it's scanned. No one is using films right now, or even the films, you can scan them and you have digital data. So it's basically images. And then you have to do some pre-processing, like reducing the artifacts. There is a scratch on the film that's not needed, remove it. Patient data, whatever. Try to do some noise reduction. Sometimes you need to eliminate the effect of different scanners. So you write your algorithm, and this happened to me. We wrote our algorithm to match a certain scanner from the database from Wright-Patterson Air Force Base Hospital. And then all of a sudden, another hospital wanted to us to try our code. And they used a different scanner. So all of our algorithms did not work. Because there are some thresholds, of course, in any algorithm. So we needed really to come to a common ground. So there's also there's always a calibration graph between the scanner and the optical density, which is the raw data, the film. So from those, I built a transform. They call it the Khaled transform. That transforms from the data to the optical density for each scanner. So now we all work on the same ground. So the same range of parameters, the threshold will always work, and this is kind of pre-processing. احنا بلشنا نشرح الان. هاي مش محاضرة بس اذا في حدا عنده سؤال يعني ممكن يعني تنتربني او يسأل. بس سؤال يعني any of you use pre-processing in his algorithm? Like what? What kind of pre-processing do you use?
It's in a special domain, the frequency domain. Especially when you use some rescaling and some adjustment for elimination. And in frequency domain, we use some Fourier transforms to bring up all of the frequencies in a particular range and filters to make sure that we so
is it helpful?
Of course.
Yeah. So this is the kind of step we're talking about. Just come to a common ground. The next step is segmentation. Of course, when you're dealing with, for example, breast image, you don't need the rib cage. There is no cancer in the rib cage, so you need to eliminate, okay, all the patient data. If you want to look at polyp in the colon, then you need to segment the colon first. Get rid of the kidney, get rid of anything else. So this is kind of putting your focus on the organ that you want to analyze. The next step, of course, is to convert the image to numbers, because all of the algorithms we're going to talk about has to deal with numbers. So you need to extract from any single region of interest some parameters that you're going to use to represent your data, like compactness. If you're talking about the mass, for example, the cancer that you saw in the breast image, or in case of lung, if you are looking for a nodule or polyp, you need to measure the sphericity of that object. Because if it's not really sphere, then most likely it's part of the colon wall. And here you can be creative. I built almost 400 or 500 features for doing my research. And of course, after that, you have to come to another step, which is feature reduction, before you apply the classification. The classification also, you have a wide range of classifiers, and this is also a very good open area for research. People say, oh, I tried this classifier, and it works better than that classifier. Now, they are not using the nearest neighbor classifier a lot, Bayesian classifier, which is a parametric classifier, is not used. They are moving towards neural network, SVM, support vector machines, which is very convenient because you don't need a lot of training data. So these are different classifiers to decide whether that nodule, that region of interest, is cancer or not. Sometimes, like in mammography, when you're doing your analysis on one view, actually when the lady goes to do the mammography, they take two views of each side. So it really helps sometimes to reduce the number of false positives to combine the findings of all four views. So if I found it on one case, it's helpful to see, oh, doctor, you need to see this patient. So no need to keep adding detection because that's going to hurt your algorithm. Because basically you're saying you will have more false positive. I'll talk about false positive. Do you know what is the meaning of false positive? Which is saying that there is cancer while it's not. True positive, there is cancer, and this, there is. So this actually is the true positive ratio, and this is the false positive ratio. And of course, as I said, there are thresholds that you can adjust, and that threshold can make you, for example, detect 100% of the true positive, but that always comes with a penalty, that you are detecting too much. As you can see here, if you are operating at this area, you are working on 100% true positive, but 100 false positive per patient. This is too much. If you want to be strict, say, I don't know, I don't need to have any false positive. Look at the accuracy or sensitivity. It's very low. So the ideal situation is to have your algorithm operating here, where it's almost 100% true positive and zero false positive. And actually, if you draw a curve and your curve is looking like that, the area under the curve is almost close to one. So some people refer to the performance of the algorithm by the area under the curve of the receiver operating curve. Okay. Any questions? This is the general introduction of the CAD. Now we will go into more specific details about the clinical applications. We will talk first about breast cancer, the mammography, as you saw. And now we have also, that was a two-dimensional images. MRI is magnetic resonance imaging and is three-dimensional. And I've done research on that, where the cancerous tissue is differentiated from non-cancerous tissue by how they absorb, they uptake the contrast material. So I'm going to show you how we can differentiate between cancerous tissue and non by breast MRI. I talk about lung cancer, colon cancer, CAD for coronary artery disease, where there is a stenosis, تضيق الشرايين. We're going to talk about the benefit of implementing all of these automation into a server that does this automatically, even without you start looking at the case. And then we're going to talk about the future vision, which is the intuition cloud that I'm going to demonstrate to you. So for this is part of my research, by the way, with what I had. As you can see here, we're looking at masses, cancers. Here, as you can see, this mass is speculated. It's like the sun rays going from the center. And there's one simple explanation for that, which is cancer follows the path of least resistance. Sorry. So, if the cancer cells find that this path has no resistance, it can grow in that direction, keeps going. Here, there is no growth, it doesn't grow. So, it will find that, you know, somehow some areas are easier to go, that's why you have that speculation. And this is a very important parameter for malignant masses. Some sort of sanity check, try to eliminate some of these detections. Yes?
About this intercepting
sanity chances? This is part of the detection. Actually, no, they depend on features like what? What do you think the feature for this detection? What? Brightness. Yes. Brightness is the feature most likely here. So here you can find that some bright region here and also some bright region here. So that's two different detection. I actually wrote a code for ICAD which is like a radial inhibition. If there are two detection that are very close to each other, then consider them as one. Because it makes sense. It's easier to process 200 candidates rather than 600 candidates. And you are not going to miss any. That's why you reduce the number of detection. Then you need to do some region growing, because the shape of the mass is important. It's actually one of the key features for determining if this is a cancer or not, just like the speculation factor I explained. So we do region growing, and then after region growing, we do another classifier based on the region growing. Like if the region is so small, there is no point of considering this as a cancer. Or if it's too big, then maybe it's you know, not cancer, or it would be very obvious for the radiologist or even, you know, for the patient itself to know that, oh, there's something wrong. So you can have some range of area, for example, to decide whether this region is cancer or not. After that, as I said, you combine the detection for the same case and you find out that you really nailed it. This is the time-dependent MR breast I told you about. These are scans for the same patient after some time. You give them contrast. After 15 minutes, you take another scan. After 30 minutes, you take another scan. And then you subtract the data. The area that's normal will have the same scan, the same contrast, and the only the difference is highlighted here. So after you do the subtraction, the color coding here, that you can, by the way, adjust, gives you an idea of which tissue are most likely to be cancers. Next, we talk about lung. For lung, you see, we have some candidates for the lung nodules. This is one of them. It's like where the center here. Okay. We can actually measure the
technical difficulty.
So we can measure the volume of that nodule, as you can see, and we will keep the findings for the radiologist to decide whether this is a true nodule or not. We will demonstrate that after the theoretical part. This is the region growing for CT and MR inside the lung. And the volume is demonstrated here. Actually, the main feature we are using for determining if this nodule is kind of worthy of further analysis is the sphericity. That's why we call it sphere detector or sphere finder. This software is incorporated in Terry Kahn's lung analysis module. And we use different algorithms, like by Medicide and by ICAD. You can even have your own algorithm implemented in our software so that you can see it, how it works. So it does the automatic identification, and you can change the sensitivity to adjust the receiver operating curve. Yes?
What do you mean by you have your own algorithm?
I'm going to explain this in a few slides. So, after you find certain measurements like this,
All these will be added to the findings. So maybe you have 10, 15 findings, and then you will look at them all and decide which one to keep, which one to reject. Virtual colonoscopy is the second application. This is the colon, and as you can see, the algorithm detected a polyp. This is a fillet view, the polyp of the colon, where it's spread open. And many radiologists like to look at it like that. These are the sagittal colon and axial views of the colon. And here we have what we call a cube view, where we concentrate on a certain detection, and that enables you to rotate it and look at it and do some measurements. We can do automatic segmentation of the colon and automatic computation of the measurements, like the volume. The fourth application I told you about is the
coronary
artery disease, which is like center line cross-section analysis. If you are looking at a vessel, and you can see here how it's stenosed. It's getting very narrow. This can be an indication of a very serious illness. Jalta, subhanAllah. So, if we can have the computer algorithm to do that and highlight this to the radiologist beforehand, this can be very helpful. I told you about all of these features. Yes?
What's the
criteria? It's usually the diameter of the vessel. Okay, because the software detects the center line automatically, and it can delineate the vessel from the other tissue, and it goes automatically throughout the vessel, and it cannot compute an average diameter and compares the actual diameter at each point with that average. So if it's very narrow, then it's less than it's very narrow, but they call it more than 50% stenosis. Okay? So if it's more than 50% stenosis, they put a marker for the radiologist to look at it. So if we can do all that automatically, like what I said, removing the bone, removing the ribcage for analysis, removing the table, for breast MR, computing that parametric mapping immediately, even before the radiologist can open the case. Like here, for example, as soon as he opens the case, you have this blue marker, then he'd say, oh, I'd better look at that. And also, as you said, the lung and colon, sphere finder, anatomy labeling, and computing the different scans, reconstruct the images in all directions. The anatomy, it can by itself find where the different parts of the anatomy are. This is all part of an advanced pre-processing filter or server. It's applying the computer-aided detection and all of that immediately. This is the part that you asked about, is that we can give you the option to try a CAD algorithm, because usually everybody tries to build his own CAD on a certain data base that he has, and that's not enough. If you want to try it, you need to try it real life on an actual data in an actual environment. And that's why we support the integration of external code in our module. You can send us that API, and just like what they did in Mayo Clinic. Does that answer your question? Okay. Now, the after you have that data in the server, then basically you can have the ability to try it from anywhere. Now, we're going to talk about the future, where we have live scan data from all over the world, all uploaded to a data center that's connected, maybe a grid of computers all over the world. It has the patient history. All stored in a massive computer center. Now we can try all kind of intelligent algorithms. You can do data mining, look at the data, look at the studies from this year, from last year. Remember what I told you about, you know, the breast cancer cases where you can detect certain case by going back 2 years and you see it was available. So you can build a trend, see that, for example, for those patients who are having this stenosis, for example, this year, last year, they were, you know, a certain percentage, or they have some kind of aptitude to have that stenosis. The fact that you have all the data in your hand and you have the massive computer power to do that, while you don't even know what we are doing with the data. We are applying everything, and if there's something interesting to you, maybe we'll send you a message saying that better careful or do that, or send your doctor a message about